Cool. Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome. My name is Brian Farnhill.
And I'm Alex Burton.
And this is the SharePoint 2013 App Playbook, your guide to building and publishing a great app. So before we get started today, I just wanted to introduce ourselves to you guys a little bit. So as I mentioned, my name is Brian Farnhill. I'm an independent consultant based out of Canberra, one of the few people who seems to think that living in the nation's capital is a good idea. But don't hold that against me too much. I'm a SharePoint Server MVP, have been for a few years running, and I'm also a part-time lecturer for Charles Sturt University, where we're doing a postgraduate course on SharePoint 2013 development.
And I'm Alex Burton, or Alexander, formal name. I'm an independent app author, so I've built a couple of apps on my own. Located in Melbourne, I'm an MVP for Project, mainly dealing with Project Server. And in my day job, I'm a product manager at Nintex, responsible for Nintex workflow online and the forthcoming Nintex workflow for Office 365 products. There you go.
Cool. Okay, so what are we going to cover in this session? We're going to give you a bit of an overview of the new app model in the Office 2013 space and what that means for us as developers. Then we're going to go into introducing some concepts for things that you can do in an app. Right? You know, it's all well and good to say we've got this new app model, but what can I actually do? So we're going to talk through some of those concepts. Then I'm going to hand over to Alex, and he's going to talk about the publishing process and how you can get your apps into the App Store and what's involved with that. And we'll finish up with a bit around how to update your app and maintain it once you've actually got that first version of it through. So hopefully we're going to cover off a fairly full cycle from beginning of an app all the way through to publishing and maintaining. And we'll have a few tips and tricks for you along the way. So overview of the app model is where we're going to kick off though. So show of hands, how many people have heard about the new app model in Office Space? Either a SharePoint apps or... Yeah, most of the hands have gone up. Excellent. Alex has, that's probably a handy thing. So what's this whole app thing about? So it's the new customization model in the Office 2013 space. And basically the focus is around being able to be a bit more flexible in our customizations and being more loosely bound against the versions of Office and versions of SharePoint that we're developing against. So the theory here is that we want to be able to reduce the amount of headaches that we as developers have to go through when developing extensions for Office and for SharePoint, but we also wanted to simplify things for the users. Right, we wanted to make it easier for users to be able to install customizations into Office and into SharePoint rather than having to have these really big processes to go through to get things installed on the servers and on the desktops and how you manage those rollouts. The new app model is designed to be able to make that simpler for everyone involved, both us as developers and the end users. So there are two main types of apps that we're going to be talking about tonight. Well, today. It's not tonight. I'm awake, I swear. The first one is apps for SharePoint. So SharePoint has a whole new model where we're focusing on being able to deploy your apps into the content databases and to connect to sites that are running remotely. Right? So I focus on doing things from the client side and doing things remotely to SharePoint and still being able to communicate and integrate just as tightly as things that are deployed to the server have been in the past. And the second one is apps for Office. We can create the same types of apps based entirely in HTML and JavaScript that can deploy into various places within Word, PowerPoint, Excel, Project, and do various different things at the client side there. But some of those will also integrate off into Office web applications as well. So we start to come to this theory of being able to write our applications once and be able to deploy it to multiple platforms. So what are the benefits of writing apps? Now, this is one of the first discussions I'll have with people around the app model is, particularly with the SharePoint stuff, you know, we've already got a way of doing things. You know, we've been doing things the server-side way or, you know, Office apps, I've been writing VSTO. Why would I shift to this new app model? So the first benefits, well, probably the main one, is around being able to use more standard development approaches. There's been a really big focus on being able to use standards like, you know, HTML and JavaScript, being able to communicate with REST calls and talk to the APIs remotely like that. No longer are we tied to strongly typed APIs that are happening at the server side. We get a lot more freedom in how we're writing things. Now, the benefit of that is up front, you don't need .NET anymore. Right? I can still write .NET and write ASP.NET applications that will run and integrate in SharePoint, and there's nothing wrong with that approach. But if for whatever reason I bumped myself in the head and decided to start writing Cold Fusion one day, I could do that and it would integrate just as neatly as something else written in .NET. The main goal that we're going for here is having few to no dependencies on the actual platform itself. Show of hands, how many people have done an upgrade of SharePoint where you've had a number of customizations involved in the project? Now, keep your hands up if that was an easy process. Yeah, that's pretty much the expectation there. By doing server-side stuff with SharePoint, you're working in a world where you're tightly bound to what's going on at the server side, and you're very dependent on everything that's happening within SharePoint because you're deploying into it. Now that we go to moving to this model of working remotely, it becomes not unlike trying to do an app for Facebook or Twitter or something to that extent, where you're dependent on the presence of an endpoint. So does that function exist, and does it, you know, expect inputs and give me the same outputs? Yep, great. That's as far as my dependencies go. You can upgrade SharePoint in the background however you want. As long as that endpoint stays the same, my app will continue to do exactly what I expect it to do. So this is going to reduce the time it takes to be able to validate solutions as we go through an upgrade process, but also make it easier for us to be able to make those changes in future, because we're going to, you know, more basic styles of APIs than just REST calls. The other great thing about the new app model is we get improved delivery channels through the new app store. I won't talk about it too much because I'll be stealing all of Alex's thunder and that'll make him sad, but we now have the ability to publish apps into a store that, again, is similar to what you get with a smartphone, where you've got an app store and say, I want to search and download whatever app it is for 99 cents. We have this ability now to publish our own apps. Any developer can do this. This isn't limited to, you know, the really big companies. Any individual who's got a good idea can develop an app, publish it up there, and hit just the same markets as everyone else is who's in that app store. And the last one is we don't have to install things on target machines. Right? If I install an app in a SharePoint, nothing gets deployed to the server. If I'm installing a Word add-in, for example, it all lives within the document file itself. We don't actually install anything on the client machine. So this means we can come back to having, you know, a cleaner environment without any specific customizations deployed and worrying about whether or not those dependencies will be affecting other applications that are deployed and if you create any conflicts there. It's all completely isolated. So what does the SharePoint app architecture look like? So I've got my SharePoint over here on the left of this particular slide. And you'll see in here I've got a number of things called app webs. Basically, at its core, a SharePoint app, in particularly with the SharePoint hosted option, is nothing more than just a subsite. Right? It's an SP web object, if you're familiar with the API. And you can do everything in those with the features that you have available that you could normally do. I could create lists. I can create custom content types, things like that, and deploy them out and have pages that are running HTML and JavaScript back to the new client-side APIs. That's all fine. So there's an option for the apps that are deployed to SharePoint. But further than that, we've now got the ability to be able to deploy things remotely. And what we can do there is we could look at, you know, Windows Azure, we could look at IIS, we could look at any other web server on the planet. As long as it's spitting out HTML and JavaScript, it has the ability to integrate just as tightly as anything written that's running directly on the SharePoint box. There are a number of controls that we get provided through the new APIs to do things like help our apps look like the SharePoint site that they're in, inheriting themes and styles, use the same sorts of controls, and be able to use these JavaScript calls or REST endpoint calls to make our apps function and integrate just as tightly as something on the server, which I think is amazing, because writing the server-side code, it can get into some trouble fairly easily if you don't know what you're doing. Right? Now that we're working remotely, we've got less chance of being able to damage our environments by writing bad code. So the office app architecture, working at what's going on inside the desktop applications like Word and PowerPoint and Excel, it's made up of a few different components. We start with our host application, so we'll use Word in this example. Inside of that is an apps for office runtime component. Now what that actually does is it talks to a sandboxed process of Internet Explorer, and your HTML and JavaScript for your apps run inside of this. And basically the apps for office runtime, what it will do is it will facilitate the communication between that Internet Explorer process and what's going on in Word. Because at the end of the day, all of those APIs for Word and the Office applications, they're all still backing on to the same APIs that have been there that we've been using in VSTO for years. But we need something that can translate a JavaScript call into something that is going to be able to be recognized by Word. So that's what that runtime is responsible for. It'll receive a request from the JavaScript to say, I need to read the text from this part of the document, or I need to edit the value in this cell on the spreadsheet. And it'll translate that into something that the application can, you know, understand, get the data back, and return it to your HTML and JavaScript. So you're completely you're cut off from what was the good fun of those COM interfaces and all sorts of things like that inside of Office. But further to that, we've got Office web applications. And the great thing here is that a large number of customizations that you'll write for Office will actually work in the web apps right now. I can create a mail app that will be able to deploy to OWA for Exchange, and people that are viewing their email in the web browser will still be able to see the exact same apps behaving in exactly the same way as they get when they're using Outlook on the desktop. So we can come to a point now where I'm writing my app once, and I don't need to worry about what device my end user is on. They're going to be able to get the app and get the same great experience that I've decided to build and hand out for them there. The thing with this one, though, is there are a couple of considerations from a security standpoint, in that you basically have an iframe, because it's just HTML and JavaScript, right? But what the iframe's got here is it's, because it's an HTML5 page, it uses the sandbox attribute. Now, what the sandbox attribute does on the iframe is it limits the functionality of what that child frame can do. All right, so it stops it from being able to manipulate cookies, to be able to access a bunch of other things to do with the parent window. It really does keep it nice and isolated, which is the focus of the apps. We don't want users, or sorry, we don't want shady developers to be able to go and write things that are going to manipulate to the actual application. So that keeps it nice and isolated there. But at the end of the day, like I said, it's HTML and JavaScript. It works in exactly the same way. So how do we go about building apps? What are our tooling options? Now, within the Microsoft stack, we've obviously got Visual Studio. Right? It's both Visual Studio 2012 and the current preview of 2013 have a whole bunch of tools specific to doing Office and SharePoint apps. And they will be able to, you know, put it all together, spit out your app package, and you can go and publish it from there. There is another option that I do like to call out here. It's an app that was codenamed Napa for Office 365. How many people have heard of Napa, just out of curiosity? Most of you. Excellent. For those of you who haven't, what Napa is it's a web-based development platform. It lets you create SharePoint-hosted apps for SharePoint and Office apps where you're writing basic HTML and JavaScript, and it will do that within the browser. So you can install Napa as an app into your Office 365 developer site and say, I would like to create a new SharePoint app, and it'll open it up and give you a nice little IDE, fairly basic compared to Visual Studio, but it gives you the ability to do it in the browser. So you could sit there with, you know, a tablet or something to that extent, as long as you've got a web browser, you can start cutting code and deploy it from there straight into your SharePoint site on Office 365 or straight into an Office application if you've got one installed and are able to run it. Realistically speaking, though, there's nothing stopping you from using any other tooling you want, particularly for the fact that we're targeting HTML and JavaScript. So if you need, as long as you can spit out HTML and JavaScript, you can use whatever environment makes sense to use. Visual Studio will package things up for you automatically. It will create your app package and let you go and upload that into the store. But at the end of the day, it's just a cab file. Right? So anyone who was a SharePoint developer in the early days of, you know, SharePoint 2003, SharePoint 2007, and was familiar with having to write scripts using makecab.exe, same sort of concept applies here. I can create this cab file myself, rename it to .app, and then take that and use it just as legitimately as something that was punched out of Visual Studio. So it really does open your options up for how you wanted to be able to develop and be able to select the tools that you think are best for the job. So now that I've introduced the framework a little, what can we actually do with apps? Because this all sounds well and good. We can, yeah, run remotely and HTML and JavaScript everywhere. Yay. What can we actually do? So in the SharePoint world, there are a bunch of different things we can do within SharePoint and both remotely to SharePoint. Right, and this probably the biggest change for a SharePoint developer from any release of SharePoint previously is this concept of trying to focus on getting things running away from the server and not doing things at the server side like we have been previously. But within the realm of staying inside of SharePoint, I can do a whole lot of things. I can basically, like I said before, the app web is just a regular web. So anything that I would normally put into a feature that gets scoped to the web level can go inside of my app. Right? All of those things are there, and they've added a few new ones as well. There are things like the client-side web part, which is a new addition, where you can create a web part that is more or less an iframe that will then show users a page from your app, but it will behave and look exactly like a web part to the end users. So basically anything we do there can go out to the web scope. The JavaScript object model is our friend in the SharePoint-hosted world, so we can't run any kind of managed code on the server if we're doing an app. So if you take the SharePoint-hosted option, you have to be able to use JavaScript to make your calls back in there. Now, the great thing about this is that the client APIs inside of SharePoint 2013 have been expanded dramatically. Now, if you've played around with things like sandbox solutions in SharePoint 2010 and you've looked at writing JavaScript for SharePoint 2010, you saw that there was a little bit of support for some REST calls through the listdata.svc service. There was some JavaScript APIs that we could wrap our stuff up into and, you know, do basic sort of list functions and things like that. Now we've got full access to a complete set of functionality within SharePoint, and we can do it from any of the client-based object models. I can now get access to things like search, user profile service, workflow, taxonomies. All of these APIs that were previously only accessible on the server side are now completely accessible through REST calls, through the JavaScript APIs, through the managed.net client, the client object model. You can get to all of these additional things now that we couldn't do remotely before. So there's been a lot of work go into being able to make the remote experience something that is going to actually work in the real world, as opposed to the, we've put it in there and it sounds nice. Right, we want to make developers be able to be productive in this remote model and not be limiting them. But when we do get to that remote model, you can run your code on anything. Like I said before, I could, if I really wanted to, I could write a cold fusion thing and it would spit out HTML and JavaScript. And as long as I've deployed my app component to SharePoint, it'll say, I know where the URL of this is. We can browse and send the user off to that. And you know, depending on how you build your app, you can make it look like SharePoint and the user might not even know they've left SharePoint, which is ultimately the goal from a user experience standpoint, depending on exactly what your app is going to do. But all of these endpoints are completely supported for being able to call in any way that you want to. Right? You don't have to call things through REST. If you're not familiar with doing things with REST, you're familiar with using the SharePoint JavaScript object model that was in 2010, then use that. Right? If you're not familiar with either of those, you're familiar with using the managed.net one, that's fine. They all translate out to calls to the exact same location. They're just wrappers around it. And the REST calls that you make just go directly to those endpoints. So it really does open it up for being able to do things the way that you want to do things, which I think is fantastic. And so we get a few different types of options for where we can integrate into SharePoint, though. And this is one of the things. If we start talking about, oh, I'm running outside of SharePoint, well, how can I hook into various parts of what's going on inside of SharePoint? Right? I need my app to get in there so users can browse out to my app in the appropriate places. Now, there are three main types of customizations that you'll find yourself building, and the icon at the bottom of this slide sort of demonstrates them reasonably well. The first one there is the immersive full-page application. Now, that's basically the equivalent of, if you've looked at Office web apps, where you, you know, you click on a document and you go to something that is a full page, that's it. If you're doing a remotely hosted thing where somebody gets directed out to your web app in its entirety, and it's a full-page experience, that's what that one is. The second one is the part. So this is things like the client-side web part and the app part. So these are ways that we can have iframes embedded on our pages. But the great thing here is to the end user, it looks and behaves just like a web part. I can create a client-side web part and I can specify its properties in XML using the same sorts of attributes that we'd normally tag properties with in our C-sharp when we were doing server-side web parts, and say that they're web browsable and mention what category they are and things like that. I can define that in XML so that when a user adds a client-side web part to a page, and they say, I want to edit properties, it looks and behaves exactly the same as the server-side web parts. It just gets passed to your iframe there through the query string. And you can even use JavaScript or your server can respond to it however it needs to based on those properties. So we're not losing functionality by going down this remote path. And the last option, though, is we can still do UI custom actions. And we can deploy these out to the host web outside of where our SharePoint app is, and provide users a way to come back into our web. Now, this means I could add buttons to the ribbon of all document libraries if my app needed to do that. So when users clicked on the button, it would take them through to my app and it would pass in query string parameters about the ID and the document library that were the user selected the item from. So we're not losing a lot of functionality as far as what we can do to integrate with SharePoint. We're just really working on that isolation between separating where SharePoint is, where your app is, and reducing the likelihood of one messing with the other. So when we talk about the SharePoint apps, there are a few options for hosting here. Now, I've mentioned the SharePoint hosted option a couple of times, and for all intents and purposes, it's the quick win. You don't need to give any thought to where you need to host stuff, which if you've been a SharePoint developer for many years, you've not had to do. You just deploy to SharePoint, right? So this lets us deploy content as HTML and JavaScript that lives inside of our site collection, and it's backed up as part of the site collection, and it's just files and content. Now, obviously, you might want to look at your remote options, and there are two remote options here. The first one at the top here is the provider-hosted app. This is the bring-your-own-hosting, do-whatever-you-want-with-it option. Now, this is great because it gives you the most flexibility, but the downside to that is you have the most responsibility for getting it right. And the biggest thing I like to call out here is around being able to handle multi-tenancy. So if you've got a provider-hosted app and you deploy it into SharePoint and you say, my remote app URL is app.contoso.com, every single person who installs that app is going to get sent to app.contoso.com. Now, the catch is they will all have a various string of query parameters that you'll be able to use to identify what site they came from. So you need to build into your apps the ability to isolate each of those individual installations and handle the complete multi-tenancy of your app yourself. There is a second option here, though, and this is the auto-hosted one. Auto-hosted apps at the moment are specifically for Office 365. And what happens with these is I can include a Windows Azure website and a SQL Azure database in my app package. So when a user goes to the store and says, I'm going to download this app, it goes and provisions those components into Azure for you automatically. It sets up the trusts between them, and basically the customer is then ready to start paying regular Azure billing rights for the running of the app there. So you don't need to worry about the hosting at all. It's completely isolated. It's automatically multi-tenanted with the fact that every installation gets its own setup of it. There are a couple of drawbacks to that option, though, mostly in that it only works in Office 365, and that they're also not accepting auto-hosted apps to the store yet. So if you look at the submission guidelines, and Alex will talk more to those later, that's one of the dot points that they're not accepting them yet. But it basically is going to boil down to doing some evaluation in your architecture of what does my app need to do, and which one of these models is going to suit it best. Right? There are some apps that SharePoint hosted is going to work fine for. Others, you might need the flexibility of what you can do in a provider-hosted app. But the functionality you can provide through the two of them is going to be fairly even. It's just how you go about doing it. What's easier to do in one might not be easier to do in the other. So there are some limitations of this approach, though, and some things to be aware of and some tips and tricks here. First of all, though, is you need to understand the restrictions on what you can do with the host web. So when I say the host web, I mean that if I install an app, it creates my subsite for my app there. The host web is the parent site in this case. And there are some rules around what you can and can't do in that. For one, if you are publishing to the App Store at the moment, you can't request the full control permission over that parent site. Right? So you're limited in things that you can do in there. You need to understand where things like custom actions will and won't work because they don't run in every single circumstance. For example, I used to be able to do a custom action to add something to the site settings page, but you can't actually do that with an app. Right? So not every custom action location will work. And there are also some things like getting the URLs of your images right for the icons that are going to go into the ribbon, in that they have to reside inside of an app URL and have, was it full URLs, then they're different URLs every time you deploy it, so it gets awkward and clunky. Just little things like that. And some of them are teething issues. You consider that the apps model here is a version one of apps for SharePoint. It's a very dramatic change. So things like this I expect will get worked out over time. But they are little things you might come up against. The second thing is to understand the restrictions of the client-side API. And I say restrictions, but it's more getting our head around the fact that we're doing things differently. And I'm talking more in the SharePoint space here rather than Office specifically. But we used to be having to have access to everything by running on the server with SharePoint. I had access to the SP Farm objects and SP Web Application objects. Well, they're not available in any of the client APIs. But then I also need to consider that if I'm running remotely, I'm now relying on a HTTP connection to talk back into SharePoint. Now, this means that by its very nature, I might not actually get a response. If the link is down between SharePoint and my app, how does my app behave? I need to get my head around writing asynchronous calls and running those rather than letting everything run sequentially like we used to do on the server. And it's a bit of a shift for SharePoint developers who haven't done work in other areas like ASP.NET or anything else outside of the SharePoint space. So some things to get your head around. What can I do in an Office app? There are a bunch of different extension types that we can do for Office apps, but the focus is just being able to around extending the functionality of a particular document within one of those applications. You can do things like reading and manipulate the contents of your documents. And basically, the focus is around being able to extend the functionality without needing to install a client application. It's just install my app and it lives within the document. So within the Office space, there are three different types of applications that we can build. The first one is the task pane app. This one you're probably reasonably familiar with if you've been doing VSTO development. It's exactly what it sounds like. It's a task pane that can live down the side of your document. And your HTML and your JavaScript will be run up inside of that, and the user can then work with your app, which then can manipulate the contents of your document. The second example here is what's called a content app. The content app is specific to Excel. And basically what it lets you do is select an area of a worksheet and then have a window appear above that that shows you your app. And that app can then manipulate with the data that was selected. So the example in the picture here is they've selected some sales numbers and it shows a map and puts up, you know, various colors to indicate, you know, the highs and lows out of that table. So you can create apps to integrate into Excel like that and help with data visualization. The third one is the Mail app. And as you probably guessed by its name, it's limited to Exchange and Outlook. But what we can do with these, and they're actually kind of cool, they showed one of these off during the keynote for those of you who saw it, the Bing Maps one, where it will detect that there is an address in the contents of that message and show Bing Maps as an option for that particular message. So when you click on it, it will show you that address on an interactive map. But you can create your own custom apps for that that will show up in specific circumstances and allow users to interact with their mail. And it's not just mail. You can also do these extensions for calendar appointments as well. So if you wanted to extend the functionality of a meeting request or something to that extent, you've got the ability to do that and target those specifically instead of mail messages. And the beauty of these is that they can be deployed off onto Exchange as well and will work in OWA. Right, so you really do get the ability to deploy anywhere off writing your code once. So the focus is on client-side development. That's basically the messaging I'm trying to get across here. We want to get away from being able to write things that are deployed to the server, away from writing things deployed to the clients for Office, and focus more on delivering truly isolated apps that can communicate through these new APIs. Now, complex tasks can be farmed out to remote web services. So an example here is if you've got a workflow that normally does some fairly heavy loading, or you've got a reporting application, you know, I could build those in and just make web service calls and host my web service on a different server somewhere else and be able to bring that data back into SharePoint that way and start separating my customizations into individual components. And the great thing about taking that approach is that I can then start scaling individual components of my application as an individual component. If I decide that my reporting application needs some more grunt, if I had been deploying it to SharePoint previously, that would mean extending my SharePoint farm, which would mean paying for more licenses, which means management will probably stab you, right? But if you've got it running on a remote server, it's just another IIS box, right? So we can go and we can spin that up, and you know, if they're using Hyper-V, they're not even paying for the licensing on the Windows OSs there, if you've got Enterprise. And there's another server that can scale out and run that component of your application. Right, so we really are loosely bound into SharePoint. And as I mentioned earlier, .NET is no longer a prerequisite. I can develop for SharePoint and not know a thing about .NET development, which sounds ridiculous when you say it out loud, but it's true. If you look at the learning curve for getting your head around doing SharePoint development, and anyone who's been doing it for more than a few years will be able to nod and agree with this, the learning curve is very steep to get your head around everything you need to know to deal with SharePoint server-side APIs. Now that we're doing it all through remote endpoints, you know, somebody who's been developing apps for the web elsewhere can say, well, I know about REST calls and, you know, I know HTML and JavaScript. Yeah, I need to know a little bit about the APIs and how things are working within SharePoint, but that learning curve for getting it right is going to be dramatically less. Right, so hopefully that's going to open the market up, particularly with the App Store, to bringing new developers into the Office and SharePoint space and creating new types of applications. So we put together a little checklist here from our playbook of things that you need to think about before you sit down and you start coding. So the first one is app functionality. Obviously, what do you want your app to do? But beyond that, can you actually do it? Making sure that the appropriate APIs are there to be able to talk back into SharePoint, talk into Office, and get you the information you need to do what your app needs to do. Next, the hosting model if you're doing a SharePoint app. You know, where is it going to live? Am I doing SharePoint hosted option? Am I doing provider hosted? If I'm targeting Office 365, am I looking at auto hosted? Doing some calculations there, figuring out what's going to work. Authentication is another one to consider as well, in that if you've got apps running remotely, you need to be able to consider what's going to happen in the authentication space there. The new remote object models give us some options around using OAuth style signatures to verify apps that are coming back in. And there's also a high trust security model that uses certificates and exchanging them between the app and SharePoint to be able to facilitate that communication. But you need to decide up front which is going to suit your app and where it's being hosted. Dependencies, does your app have any? You're able to specify things like that in your app manifest for SharePoint. For example, if I'm writing an app that needs to be able to read from a managed metadata store, I can actually flag that as a dependency in my app to say, you need this managed metadata service. So when a user goes to install it, if they don't have that service provisioned in that site, it will actually tell them, you can't install this because you've got dependencies that don't, you haven't met all the dependencies for this application. So we get the ability to control all of that. And the last dot point here is licensing approaches. Now, I'm not going to talk in too much detail about this, for we're not one of stealing Alex's thunder yet again, but there are a number of things that you're going to need to consider around how you manage licensing and selling of your application, particularly if you're going through the public app store. So I think that's enough of me just randomly standing around and talking. Let's get into a demo and show you guys some of this stuff. Cool. All right, so the new SDKs that we have for Office 2013 and SharePoint 2013 are available through the web platform installer, and they install directly into Visual Studio 2012, so you can just download them and install them there. Once you've got them installed, I can select, I want to create a new project. And I now have an option in here that lets me specify apps under Office and SharePoint. So I get two different options. I get an option to do an app for Office and an app for SharePoint. All right, so they set up different project types within Visual Studio. So let's say I want to create a SharePoint app here. I'll leave it called SharePoint App 1. I specify a URL here. All right, so this will be where it's going to deploy the app to for debugging purposes. It's not as tightly bound as the URL was for a server-side solution that we had previously, where it would check for a lot of dependencies and things like that that already existed in the site. This is more just, I need to know where to provision this so I can set the app up inside of that. And the last option it asks us here is, how do we want to host this? So as I mentioned, there were the three options for hosting. The auto-hosted, the provider-hosted, and the SharePoint-hosted. So if I go and choose provider hosted here, just to show you what you get, the next question it asks me is, how do you want to authenticate? So I mentioned that you need to give some consideration to that authentication experience. So the first option there is to use a client secret, which requires a SharePoint farm connected to the Windows Azure access control services. So the OAuth management there relies on ACS to validate those tokens. The second option is to use a certificate, and this is the high trust model that I mentioned. So if you're doing a provider hosted app, you've got those options there. For the sake of keeping this simple, I'm just going to say, here's a SharePoint hosted app. You see, I don't get a next button at all, I go straight to finish. It doesn't need to know anything else if I'm doing it as a SharePoint hosted. Oops. Apparently I can't type my password. There we go. Okay, so I get my app here. Now, if you look over here in the Solution Explorer, if you've been working on SharePoint's development before, there's a few things here that are going to look very familiar to you. I still have a features directory, I still have a package directory, and they both do exactly what you think they do. At the end of the day, the app component still has a WSP inside of it, and the schema is exactly the same. So when I say that we have web-scoped features, your app is allowed to include a single web-scoped feature. And this does everything that we could do with web-scoped stuff before. So in this case, what I've got by default is a bunch of module elements. All these modules are doing are deploying my default.aspx page, my JavaScript, my CSS, things like that. And if I have a look at the default.aspx page it gives us, I'll just zoom in over here, you see I'm actually using the master page model that is within SharePoint, so I don't actually need to worry about inheriting styles or colors or anything like that. If somebody changes the theme of the host web, it's automatically going to be reflected in this app for me. And I start targeting all the usual placeholders that we're used to targeting as SharePoint developers. You know, I've got my placeholder main, my placeholder additional page head, all the things that we're used to doing. Nothing dramatically different going on here. So what the app that they give you by default does, it gives you an app.js. Now, inside of this, it's just a basic call to the JavaScript object model to load the name of the current user. So if you've used the JavaScript object model at all for SharePoint 2010, it behaves in a similar way. We queue up the calls of what we need it to execute, we call our execute query method, get our results back, and trigger an update from there. So that if I go and run that app, it's just going to say, hello, administrator. Really basic example just to show you how that works. Now, if I wanted to start looking at creating Office apps, I get, again, go back out and say, I want to create a new project. But one of the things that we can do with the tooling now is I can actually create an Office app that gets deployed inside of my SharePoint app. Now, it does make sense to be able to include the two in a lot of cases where I might have an Office app that depends on specific things inside of SharePoint. So I can actually add the Office app into the project here. So if I say I want to add a new item, I've got the option down here of creating an app for Office. If I select that, it'll be able to add it to my project, and it gives me the same wizard that I get if I had created this as a project on its own. So the first thing it goes and it asks us is, what type of app are you going to do? So I mentioned there were the three types of apps: the task pane app, the content app for Excel, and the mail app. All right, so I can choose one of those, tick the corresponding application, so I can write one task pane app that will work across Word, Excel, PowerPoint, and Project. But I don't need to create separate extensions for each one of those applications. I can create the content app or the mail app. You see the options at the bottom there. Let me specify, is this an appointment or is it an email message app? So we can separate those out there. For this example, I'm just going to say it's a Word app. I don't have Project installed on this machine. No, it's not Alex's machine. He would... Okay, so the next question it asks us is it says, do you want to create a new document and insert the app into there or insert it into an existing document? What happens with the apps for Office is they actually get attached to a document. So we're not installing something that's going to be across every time you open Word up. It's going to be there for the documents that you install that app into. So in this case, I'm going to tell it, give me a new Word document and chuck my app into there. And a few little loading things later. You can see what I have now is Office App 1 and Office App 1 Manifest. All right, so it's created this app and built it in there, and I can now open up my HTML file for that. And here's a bunch of HTML for my document here that's going to be in the app. So rather than stand here and type out a whole lot of code just to show you how I can, you know, type and make typos and mistakes, here's one I prepared earlier. So let's close that and show you this. So what I'm going to do now is flick over to here and show you what it looks like. So here's a SharePoint app. What I've got this app is I want users to be able to come and submit articles to go into the corporate newsletter. So I can come in here and say, hello world, this is Tech Ed. And I'm going to make that bold and I'm going to make that huge and submit my article. Now that's actually just storing things inside of a list. Right, so I've got a list in my app web here, and all I'm doing is calling the REST endpoints to push that data in. Now, what my Word document is going to do is it's actually going to read items out of that list and let me inject them into the document to actually build the newsletter. So I'll say edit document here. So you can see I've given it a template of, you know, having a header there. I could put up more content in if I wanted. But you see what runs up on the right over here is my actual application. Now, this application's read all the data from the SharePoint list, and I can select which of the newsletter articles I'd like to insert into the document. So I could say, yep, we're now using SharePoint 2013 and insert that. And you see what's happened is I've now got a chunk of text in my document that's followed heading structure, it's followed paragraphs, lists, links, and basic formatting as just interpreting that HTML and putting it into the document. So I'm going to run through the code for some of this, and I'm going to do it quickly so Alex doesn't get angry at me for taking too much time. So the SharePoint component is reasonably straightforward. So what I'm going to do here is, pages, default.spx. So all that I've got in my page, as you can see, it's a fairly clean chunk of HTML. Now, the rich text editor you saw there was just some random one that I found on the internet, right? You're not bound to using SharePoint controls. You can use whatever you want. It's JavaScript, right? And there's a million different JavaScript rich text editors out there. Grab whatever you feel like using. What's actually going on in the code, though, inside of my JavaScript, is that on my document.ready, I'm adding a click function to my submit button. Now, in this particular case, I've decided I wanted to use the SharePoint JavaScript wrappers and be able to create my new item like that. So I've just added title and body and pushed it into the list. All right, so if you've done JavaScript with SharePoint 2010, nothing new here. This is exactly the same. Now, What I've done inside of the Office app, though, is a little bit different. Inside of my Office app, whoops, that's the list, Office app, newsletter builder. So my HTML, again, quite clean, just an empty select list. So I'm going to populate that on load. And what I'm doing in this particular case is I'm calling the REST endpoint. So I build up my URL, so to the underscore API directory, lists get by title, newsletter articles, slash items. I tell it I want JSON data as a response, and it's just a jQuery AJAX request at this point. Nothing complicated about that at all if you've done any JavaScript stuff. Then I just create myself a little array of my items, populate them out and inject the HTML, and they're there ready to select. Now, when it comes time to being able to inject that into the Word document, is we get a bunch of functionality and APIs around that. So you see that line in the middle of the screen there, office.context.document.setSelectedDataAsync. This is where I'm building up a chunk of HTML, including the title of that article and the actual content, and I'm telling it inject it into the document. Now, all of the APIs that we're calling from Office, they are asynchronous, right? So I can't just hang on to a method. I have to call the call it and then say, on an error, do this. On success, do this. But in this case, it's just say, go and put the text in at the particular spot where the cursor is. Right? So fairly straightforward. The APIs here aren't complicated, and there's good documentation for them on MSDN. So the last thing that I was going to show you quickly was just the manifest files. So within when you do both a SharePoint app and a Office app, you get the ability to specify what goes into the manifest. Now, the manifest is an XML file that tells SharePoint or tells Office everything it needs to know about your app. So in this case, it's name, version number, icon, what the start page is, how it's hosted. Within SharePoint, I can also request specific permissions. Now, this might be, I need to read items from your site collection. I need to read user profiles. I need to read from search, or I need to update items somewhere. You can specify all of these so that when the user installs the app, they get a little, this app is going to do the following. Do you trust it? Right? And it's up to the user to be able to say, yes, I trust that app. I'm giving it permissions to do those things. And let's go from there. Prerequisites. I've got the ability to specify auto-hosting prereqs, like a website and a SQL database. Or I've also got the capability prerequisites. So this lets me say if specific service applications or services are required, I can select them from this drop-down list here so that if the user doesn't have, say, Visio services, they'll actually get a message when they go to install it saying you need Visio before I'm going to let you install this app. So that whole experience there is managed to ensure that what your app needs will be there when you deploy it. We have the ability to do locales and regionalization of your application. And lastly, we can specify remote endpoints for flagging that this app needs to talk to specific external URLs, which SharePoint will make the user aware of so that they can again flag that in the trust menu. The manifest for the Office applications is a fairly similar experience. I get to specify the capabilities or the name and version, that sort of thing, and just the app domains for if I'm talking to remote endpoints as well. But that's basically it, right? So that's the SharePoint hosted app model, and that's a task pane application using HTML and JavaScript and SharePoint and Office talking together there. So at this point, I'm going to hand over to Alex.
Thank you, Brian. So we've seen how you can build an app. Brian's got some example there that's shown us how to build. What we want to do now is get that app out there. We want to get it out to our customers. And the question is, how do we? How do we publish an app? Well, if you've ever spoken to a SharePoint MCM, the answer is, it depends. They'll tell you that for everything. Really, you have two options. You've got the Office Store. So this is a global store that's available to all users of Office 2013, SharePoint 2013, Project Server 2013, Office 365, Office 365D. They all have access to this, okay? So if you put your app in this store, that's a stack of customers, potentially, that will see your product. You also have an option for an internal app store, an app store that's only relevant within your organization, a thing called the App Catalog. Provides most of the features of the Office Store, but has some limitations, and we'll have a brief look at those now. So to start with, audience, already mentioned, the Office Store is public, it's global, it's available to everyone. It's available in a number of languages. And if you're sitting there in the French, in France, sorry, and you're using the French language version of SharePoint, you can still get into the Office Store and look at the English version, or you can look at a localized version. Okay, so that Office Store is there truly for everyone. The app catalog, as the name suggests, is internal to your organization. Okay, and the reason you might want to consider this is if you have an app that has your own IP in it. It has IP only relevant for your organization. It's an app that talks to a bespoke system within your organization. Something you might not want to release publicly. The app catalog is only available to those users who have access to that SharePoint farm. Okay, it's a big distinction. Global, few people. You can work that one out. From a licensing perspective, the Office Store provides APIs for licensing, and you can work out how you wish to license your app. Now, as Brian said before, you need to make that consideration up front. Are you going to license it on a per-user basis? Are you going to license it on a site basis? Are you going to use a subscription license? If you are, then you're not going to use the Office Store because it's not available. Okay, you have to roll your own at the moment. The app catalog does not have licensing. Okay, the idea is it's inside your organization. You don't need to license it. From a commerce perspective, the Office Store provides a commerce engine. So you can set your price. Microsoft will then take care of collecting the fees from users, from organizations, and paying that back to you. Okay? They'll clip the ticket a little bit, but they take all that pain away from you. The App Store, the App Catalog, as you'd expect, doesn't have it. From a hosting perspective, Microsoft take care of the hosting of the Office Store. It's scaled, it's globally available, it's got 100% or 99.9% uptime. Whereas the app catalog sits in a site collection within your SharePoint instance, either on-prem or inside Office 365. The most important one's around validation and verification, and we're going to dive into this in a bit more detail. Every app you put through the Office Store undergoes an incredibly rigorous validation and verification process. There's a few people in here I know that will be nodding because they've gone through that, and we're going to take you through today with our playbook of giving you some tips to get you through there as quickly and as easily as possible, okay? From an app catalog perspective, the verification and validation is automated. And really, they look at the app manifest to make sure that the app is well-formed. If you can upload it into the app catalog, you're good to go. The final thing's around registration. The Office Store, you need to register before you can get an account. The app catalog, well, you just need access. So the process of getting it into the Office Store, you've got to come this side now.
I did spend a lot of time over here, just so you know,
there's some people over here.
That's fine.
Okay. getting it into the App Store. So the first thing you need to do is you need to set up a seller dashboard. That's your portal into the App Store. That's where you will submit your app, and we'll show you it in a moment, give you an idea of how easy it is to use, and how you can set that up. Then you need to submit the app, okay? You get your app. And push it up, Microsoft, and then validate it. Now, if I was a liar, I'd say everything was good and it'd approve about, you know, a day later. It doesn't. It goes around in a circle that looks very much like this. Okay? It will go back and forth. However, as you've been to this session, you will pick up some tips and tricks, and hopefully you'll go through first time. Once it's passed validation, you're approved, and the app's then available in the store for everyone to start downloading it and to start buying it, I guess. So to start with, setting up the seller dashboard. There are two types of accounts. There's an individual and there's a company account. The amount of information that you need to provide and the process is slightly different depending on which you pick. Individual account is for me. It's for a person who's not a commercial entity. I'm not a company. I'm just a person that publishes apps for fun. Okay? Very simple to set it up. I put my name and address information in, and after it goes through an approval process, I'm ready to go. From a company perspective, you'll get asked slightly different information. Some will need to become a reference for your company, so you need to give reference information for your company and company details. If you're going to sell an app, you need to put in payout information. So that's if you're going to use the e-commerce engine within the Office Store and you want to get money paid out to you, you need to submit information about your bank details or PayPal. Okay, so they'll pay out when they clip the ticket. After they clip the ticket, you will get your payout information, payout details come through on a monthly basis. Back up a moment. Once you've done that, you submit your App Store, your seller dashboard account for approval. And this is the important thing. It needs to be approved, okay? It takes a couple of days for it to happen, but until it's approved, you cannot submit your app, okay? So it's important that you go through that process and make sure that you've got this approved before you're ready to put your app in. Finally, before you can start submitting apps, you need to link a paid Office 365 dev account. So this came in a few months ago. You need to have that account linked into your seller dashboard before it will let you update one. Now, how you get one of these? If you have an MSDN Ultimate or Premium, you've got access to one. It's in your benefits. If you're on an E1 or an E3 365 account, you can provision a dev site collection and use that to link through. Or you can request a trial, and we'll put up the links and the links at the end of this.
They're in the
slides at the end. Yeah. Which will show you how you get that trial. The trial to convert to a proper account is about $100. It's not a big amount of money. But until you've linked those linked your dev account to your seller dashboard, you can't submit an app. So I'm going to back up a bit. Brian showed us how to code. You did a naughty because you didn't talk about this.
I didn't want to steal your thunder, man. If I left you with nothing to talk about, you'd cry.
It is so very important you understand the validation policies inside out before you start coding, okay? Validation policies cover everything Microsoft's going to look at when you put it into the Office store. So things like, does my app provide value? Okay, does it actually do something? Or is it just a vector for malware or ads, okay? Does my app have in-app purchases, okay? It'd be a devil to get, I don't know, 3 months into development and build a product that has in-app purchases to find out, oh my God, they don't support it, what have we done? So you need to understand that. Yes, you can put in-app purchases. The Office App Store itself does not support that at the moment. The app needs to behave predictably. So when I click on something, it needs to do something, okay? It needs to tell the user that it's doing things. It can't start pop-up windows everywhere, okay? So it needs to be predictable. Likewise, you have to put the app in, the customer in control. So no doing stuff without their permission. It's horrible that it has to be said, but the app needs to be appropriate for a global audience. No threatening remarks in there, no pornography. All of the things you would expect, it's stated in the app guidelines. In fact, there's 70 different app guidelines that you need to understand, okay, and be across. Finally, app updates must not decrease. So this is an interesting one. Maybe you put an app out there and you thought, yeah, this is a great idea, I'll put it out for free. And it goes gangbusters. You've got 20,000 downloads. People are installing it, think it's brilliant. So you decide, I know, I'll take that feature out and I'll charge you $10 for it, okay, in the update. Well, you can't do that, okay? That's naughty. That's outlawed. So just bear that in mind.
Bad developers,
yeah. You have to support refunds. If you're using the commercial side of the product of the app store, you need to support refunds. People may want to refund or request a refund. And finally, you need to utilize supported capabilities. No writing apps on premise that do naughties, like go and look at content DBs, although I don't think that's possible, but you get the idea. You can't go calling those undocumented features that you've heard about from someone in the bar at TechEd, okay? As I said before, 70 different rules. You guys need to know these inside out, preferably before you start coding. Have a copy of this printed out on your desk, okay? Sounds sad, I do. There's been 5 different versions of this, so we're on the 5th revision, which came out in June. Okay, so they do change as well. So keep an eye on those. So I guess going with our playbook, we have a submission checklist, some things that I wanted to make sure from my experience of authoring apps myself, but also as being responsible for the Nintex products, things that we've come up with, things that we thought were important that I wanted to share with you. Check the validation policy. I can't say that enough. I might have got a T-shirt or something with that on. Make sure you're across the validation policy. Make sure you are dev complete when you submit. If you put something in that's half done, it's half baked, you'll fail. Worse, it might get through their testing and it will go out to the public and everyone's going to see a half baked app. Okay, so you only get one shot at it. You can't just put in an like in Office 365 development, you can use a CAF tool and you can assess how you're going. Not with this. It's put it in and you're ready to go. You're pushing the button. Make sure you've tested the app, and you've tested the app well. You've tested it every possible way. If it's a new app, you've tested the new app install experience. If it's an upgrade, you've tested the upgrade experience. Icons, I've been got with this one. Make sure your icons are the right size, okay? Make sure your icon inside your app matches the icon you put into the seller dashboard. I did an app where I had a really flash-looking transparent icon. I was really proud of it because it picked up the theming of SharePoint. It looked really good. Unfortunately, I put a nice green background one in my app, and it got failed, and I was a week in before I could fix it. Marketing copy. Your app's going out through this dashboard, through this app store. You need to draw people in. People need to see this app, and they want to go and buy it. So there's two things that will do that. The copy, the description, or the marketing information about your app, and the screenshots. So if you're in a commercial organization, make sure you've got that copy written, and it's been signed off. I know I have to go through getting my stuff signed off at work, and that can take a few days to do. So make sure you've got it signed off, and you're ready for that submission when your devs turn around and say, we're finished. Every app you put in requires support and privacy links. You have to provide links to that. So even if you're just doing stuff for yourself, you need a support policy, and you need a privacy policy. Okay, they're mandatory fields. Screenshots I've already spoken about. And the final thing is submission guidelines. Microsoft are really, really good. They provide a list of common problems. Things like not updating the manifest version number seems to be a common one. So as things come up, they put it in a list of common problems. And those common problems and that list are in the links that we'll provide at the end of this session. Now, if anyone knows me, I can't stop talking. So I've actually got some real ones now, some stuff that has happened to me. Test all supported browsers. This is a big one. When you're putting an app into the App Store for SharePoint, your supported browsers are the current version of Chrome, current version of Firefox, Internet Explorer 9, 10, okay? Internet Explorer 8 is optional, so you don't have to support it if you state that you don't. Internet Explorer 11 is not yet a requirement, but I wouldn't hold your breath on that not changing in the near future, so maybe test that as well. So make sure you test them. For other apps, Office web apps, I believe Safari comes into the mix.
Yep.
And they're different, as you'd expect. Safari's there for some, it's not there for SharePoint. The validation policies outline that. Make sure the app does what you say. If you have an app that publishes all projects, then make sure it publishes all projects. I learned that the hard way, okay? So that was a little bug that got there. Provide feedback to the user. Make sure the user knows what you are doing, okay? You don't want a screen to go white for 30 seconds because the user starts to get freaked out, okay? So you need to provide feedback. You put spinners up. You put messages up. You make sure you give that feedback, all part of good user experience and user design. Make sure you ask for the permissions you need. Brian showed the permissions piece down in the project manifest. Only ask for what you need. So if you need to talk to project into project center in project server, which my app does, make sure you ask for that. I had a situation where we cut a feature at the last minute, and I didn't need that permission anymore, but unfortunately it stayed in the manifest. The app failed, okay? It cost me a week. Hopefully you guys will pick up on that and you won't need that. The last thing, the testing, okay? This one's a bit strange. They test the apps using a combination of automated and manual testing. In fact, there's a testing team based out of Ireland that do the testing. Now, if your app is complicated, if you're building a massive enterprise app, like we did with the Nintex Workflow Online products, we wrote a stack of test notes and test cases that we could pass on to the testers so they would get an understanding of our app, and therefore streamline that process of approving and reviewing the app, okay? Seems quite simple quite simple when you think about it, but it is incredibly important, okay? So I can't stress that one enough. So with that, I am now, thank you. I'll show you the seller dashboard. And this is a real life one. This is a product that I wrote myself. And I'm going to click into it just to take you through how simple this is to use. This is a seller dashboard I've already registered for. You log on with with your MS account. And you can see here, I've got my app. It's an app for SharePoint, publish all enterprise projects. Not publish all projects. That's where I got caught. That's why I renamed it. And you'll see it's already published. It's been out there since Christmas last year. But also, with the App Store, I can create a second one. So what I'm going to do is I'm just going to go in and I'm going to edit a draft for an update. We'll pretend we're doing an update. I'm just going to take you through the process. So I put in my information. You can see it's a simple wizard. I can go through and put my information in, my version number. The version number needs to match the one in your manifest. Okay, that's a good one if you're putting an update through. Bear that one in mind. There's this release date field here, which is where you can request a release date. Okay, it's not the date it's going to go live. But that's what you are wishful thinking of when it will go live. Okay, you can pick categories. Have a think about what you want here. We've got a number of different categories. Put our logo in, upload our package. Now, if you're using OAuth, you can pick your OAuth that you set up previously, your client ID, so that you match up your client ID and your secret. Testing notes. So there's some notes here to the tester. You can put those in, or you can create a document, stick it in your SkyDrive account, and give the guys access to those to that account. Just like any app store, there's a cryptography declaration. So you need to state whether or not your app uses cryptography. Mine one doesn't, but you get the idea. There's a lot of stuff there that you need to make sure that you've got that answer for when it comes to the time to submit. My privacy link, my support link, click through. Oops, what have I done? Oops, let's turn that off. It's got validation. And now I can come in and I can put in my marketing description. This is a description that'll show up in the App Store itself. So I can choose my language. I put my screenshots in. Bear in mind the screenshots are of a funky resolution, so you need to make sure you've got those sized correctly. And if I want, I can add other languages. So recently, the Office Store added the capability to submit in native languages for, if I click here, Spanish, French, German, and Japanese. So it's not just an English store now. You also have access to these stores. Let's come out of that. You get the idea. Now, once we're happy with that, we press, I'm not going to do it, submit draft for approval, and that's it. The App Store submission's in. And the testers in Microsoft will start looking at it. Now, if you submit this by mistake, unfortunately, you've got no recourse. You can't unapprove it. You just need to send an email through to the team, through the news groups, and they can stop the submission for you. But be really careful. Only press that button when you're ready to submit. Okay? Still V1. So with that, I might just flip to my slides. Okay. So we've submitted. It'll then go into the validation process. And as I kind of alluded to, there is no SLA. There is no guarantee that your app will go through for the date that you state. I've had apps go through in a week. I've had apps go through in 4 weeks. You get the idea. It depends on what they find, how complicated the apps are, and how good a job you've done of preparing their testers to test them. There is no configurable go-live date. This is a big one. If you're a commercial organization and you're going to put an app out, you kind of want to have everything waiting. You want your websites, you want your press releases, you want all this stuff queued up, ready to go. There is no guaranteed configurable go-live date. There is no button you can push to say, make it appear. Okay, so you need to be mindful of that. The first time you do it will be the longest, and as we've always already said, it's a combination of analysis and human testing, so make sure you've got those tester notes in there. So you will most likely see some of these. You get these nice little automated, unfortunately, your app has some recommended changes. And when you log in, you'll go to your seller dashboard, you'll see a report, and that report will show you what those changes are based on the validation policy and where it's failed. But then, you'll get one of these, and you'll go, yay. And then about 4 to 6 hours later, it will propagate, and it will make its way around the world, and it will appear in the App Store, and people will come along, and they will start downloading it, will start buying it. Okay, even better, and then you'll start seeing the money rolling, which is what you want. So our app's out there, people are buying it, people are using it. What do we do now? We want to update that app. We want to maintain that app. We want to keep an eye on that app now it's out there in the wild. Okay. I'm going to talk very briefly about how you monitor it in the wild, because this is something that I think most people forget about. When you release your app, the seller dashboard still can provide you with useful information. It can give you things like download numbers, so you know how popular your app is, how many people have downloaded it. It will also tell you how many people have installed it, uninstalled it, having issues, problems upgrading, all those kind of things, they're there too. You can get some kind of rough and ready metric of how your app's performing. I'm quickly going to show you that. Thanks.
Where are we, seven?
Seven.
So if I come out of here, and no one laugh, because the numbers aren't great. Project Server is a specialized field, as most of you know.
It's okay. Special.
So you see here that the site, since it went live at Christmas, 6,376 hits, and it's had a total of 86 downloads. Now, luckily, I made this free, because if I was betting my retirement on it, I don't think I'd be making a lot of money. But you get the idea. You get some quite nifty statistics. Now, the problem with this is it only gives you the last 4 weeks, okay? So you have to log in and get that information. But it's pretty good for what it does. If you just want some insights, it's a good thing. Another thing to consider is logs and telemetry. If you're using a provider-hosted app, if you're hosting your stuff in your own backend, you have access to the code there. You can go in and put your own logs in. You can put your own telemetry in and get an idea of how people are using the app. Now, from experience, things like Google Analytics are also an option. You could put a Google bug in your code to see where your app's been installed. Now, a lesson learnt there is, one, corporations block them, okay, so you don't get complete coverage. As you won't always see where the app's being used. And the second thing, the EU introduced some rather nifty cookie laws recently, and the Google thing drops cookies. So you need to make sure that you take that into account and the legal implications of using that. So I'll just throw that one out there. Another way of getting feedback around your app and what it's doing out there in the wild is support forums. Okay, setting up a user voice forum can be a great thing to do. And in fact, we're doing that with the forthcoming version of Workflow. We have an inbuilt user voice where people can submit feedback requests, they can vote on other feedback requests, submit bugs, all from within the app itself. Okay, it's a pretty powerful thing. And the final thing that people possibly don't think about is maintaining reference deployments. What I mean by reference deployments is, when your app is out there in the wild, people have different environments. They have SharePoint that's patched with April CU. They have Office 365 that's in, say, the Brazilian data center. These can have different different patch structure. Okay, Office 365 doesn't get patched overnight at the same time. They roll it around the world. Okay, so Nintex maintains four different accounts in different regions so that we can see patterns. When stuff's rolled out, we can see if whether or not our app has a problem as it's rolling out around the world, and then we can react to it, because we don't get any forward notification that there's a patch coming through. So reference deployments can be a very useful thing if you've got that app out there in the wild. And I know we're running short of time, so I'm going to do my last slide. I'm going to go this side now. I've got my Fitbit on, so I'm doing really well today. Last thing is around updating your app. Okay, so the first question, the most important question, is do you need to update your app? Okay, you've had that feedback from your users. Do I need to roll out that new feature? Do I need to make that bug fix? Well, if you're using a provider-hosted model that Brian spoke about before, the answer may well be no, because you can change the back end without necessarily having to submit your app for approval again and going through all that stuff that I spoke about before. So keep that in mind when you're sitting down looking at the validation policies and thinking about how you're going to license the app. Bear that in mind. When you do update the app, treat it like it is a new app, okay? You've got to treat it like it's a brand new app, not making a simple change. People will still come along. They will be installing your new version as if it was the first time. A big one that's overlooked is that updates are optional. So people can still run on the first version of your app. So if you have APIs that only the first version of your app uses, you need to maintain those APIs. Okay, so when they upgrade to the next version, then they need to use your new APIs. But you need to take that into account or plan ahead, significantly plan ahead so that you don't get tripped up that way. And the final thing is when you roll an update out, it can take up to 24 hours for that person to see there is an update there. Now, I'm very briefly going to show you, what that looks like. So I'm just going to show you an update very quickly. We're running very short on time. I was going to take you through a few of the update mechanics, but I'm going to flick through that. But when you update an app inside SharePoint, I don't think many people have seen this. When the app gets updated, SharePoint will poll, and it will come up about 24 hours later to say that there's an app update available. I'm going to show you this. I've got this wonderful app I poured my heart and soul into, so you're all going to see it. In fact, I'll get the doors locked. okay. So there's my app.
Obviously, see, I think that app's perfect. That shouldn't change. That should stay exactly as it is.
Thank you, Brian. So obviously, I'll just... Which one's zoom it?
Control one.
Control one. Fantastic. Obviously, it's got a bug because I got the picture wrong.
Lies.
But as you can see, you get the an indication. The update is available for this app. So to update the app to my next version, all I do is click on the button. What it's doing now is it's picking up the new version of the app that I've got deployed to the store, or in this case, to my corporate catalog, okay, or to my app catalog. And it's showing me I've got a new version available there. And do I want to get it? And you'll see here it says it's version 2. Okay, going to click on the Get It button. It's going to ask me, do I trust it? Again, now bear in mind, when you upgrade your apps, you may change the permissions you request. And that's changed in the manifest that Brian showed you before. So it always asks you to retrust. That's fine, I'm going to trust it. And the app is now going to go off and do its upgrade. It's going to pull down the bits. It's going to pull down the app manifest, the app component, the app web components, the host web components, if there were any. And it's going to upgrade, and it's all going to do it in one atomic unit, because if this fails, it will roll them back for me. Now, luckily, it's not going to fail, and in a moment, that's going to look awesome.
I love seeing you sweat like this.
Yeah, I know. Yeah. Now, I'm using Office 365 because I'm a brave person, unlike Brian.
Okay, Alex.
Yeah, I'll come back to that. That's a good point. You can, but you have to maintain the same level of functionality for the previous users.
Including the price.
Yeah, if you offered it for free, so that the validation policies, one of the 70 in there will tell you that. It's specified explicitly. Yeah, good point.
So if you then have an additional functionality to the...
Thank you.
I'm going to write the worst review for that app ever.
Just because we're running out of time. So just quickly to review what we saw. We saw an overview of the app model. Brian took us through different things about the app model. What you can build in an app. We showed you how easy it was to publish, giving you some tips and tricks, hopefully, that will make the publishing process easier for you and less painful. And very briefly went through updating and maintaining an app. Now, we had some other demos and stuff, but unfortunately, we ended up running a little long, which we'll put up on the blog, on the various blogs after the session. Some useful links. dev.office.com, this is a brilliant site. They just refreshed all of their training information. Go there, learn about SharePoint apps, Office apps, learn how to build them, and then bookmark the App Store validation policy, because maybe it's just me that bookmarks stuff like that. I don't know. call to action. Go to dev.office.com, try it out, register for a dev account, try it, build one, submit it to the store, and make millions. There you go. That's my call to action for you all. I want you all to come back next year in your corporate jets and tell me how wonderful you did in the App Store and you've made millions of dollars. So with that, I've been Brian Farnhill. You've been Alex Burton.
Why not?
Thanks for your time. Has anyone got any questions before we
I think we're short on time, so we might just hang around here and answer some questions. So if you've got questions, feel free to come up and have a chat with us here. If you miss us here, we'll be down at the office showcase for a little bit of time. Thank you, guys.